السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله الذي خلق الإنسان فسواه فعدله في أي صورة ما شاء ركبه وأنعم عليه بنعم سابغات ولو شاء منعه وشق له سمعه وبصره وجعل له لسانا فأنطقه وخلق له عقلا وكلفه وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد صفوة خلقه وعلى آله المطهرين وطيب صحبه وبعد فقد قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم وسارعوا إلى مغفرة من ربكم وجنة عرضها السماوات والأرض أعدت للمتقين الذين ينفقون في السراء والضراء والكاظمين الغيظ والعافين عن الناس والله يحب المحسنين صدق الله العظيم. InshaAllah, today I will be moving slightly away from the topic of Hajj and the Muharram, the first 10 days, as the Shaykh spoke about extensively last week. Today I want to speak about something that which we don't usually hear about, something which is ignored but prevalent within our community, within society, within the country, within ourselves. Something which is applicable to the young and the old, to the senior and the junior, to the retired and the students, to the working person and everyone that we know. Something that we dismiss and we don't think about it, but it is there in the society. A person came to the Prophet, peace be upon him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as mentioned by the on the authority of Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, and he came and he said, O Messenger of Allah, dullani ala amalin yadkhulul jannah. O Messenger of Allah, please direct me, guide me towards an action through which I will be able to enter Jannah. And not only that, وَلَا تُكْفِرْ عَلَيْهِ, and don't make it excessive upon me. Don't give me a lot of advice. I just want one thing, that when I adopt this in my life, it will become the means of me entering Jannah. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he responded and he gave him the answer and he says, لا تغضب. لا تغضب. That do not become angry. فَرَدَّهُ مِرَارًا. And then the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, he repeated this many, many times. لا تغضب. Do not become angry. Do not become angry. Do not become angry. Now when we evaluate ourselves and we look at ourselves and we look at society around us, many a times we do things in haste. Many a times we do things in anger, which we only live to regret. We don't think about the consequences of the time. We don't look at the future. We don't think five steps ahead. And we work and we take action in haste, in anger, and then we regret it. Let's look at what happened in the seerah, in the life of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was sitting with the companions, and amongst them was none other than Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. And a man came and he began to abuse and he began to swear and mock at Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu, and he's calling him the names, everything you can think of under the sun. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he sat there silently, didn't say a single word. We have the Messenger of Allah, imagine that, he's also sitting there silently, not a single word. Now this person, he said whatever he had to say, and then he went quiet. And at that moment, Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he opened his mouth to retaliate, to respond to this person. At which the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, he stood up and he left. He walked away. Now Abu Bakr is confused, radiallahu anhu. Why is it that he is leaving? This person has been abusing me all this time, and he did not retaliate on behalf of me, he did not say anything on behalf of me. And yet, as soon as I open my mouth, he stands up and he leaves. So Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, he stood up and he began to follow the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And we caught up to him, he said, O Messenger of Allah, this person was abusing me. And as soon as I opened my mouth and you left, why, O Messenger of Allah? He says that whilst he was sitting there silently, Allah had appointed an angel to respond on behalf of you. So as soon as the person was saying these things to you, the angel was responding on behalf of you. But you opened your mouth and the angel had left. And not only that, Shaitan came and sat in his place. Shaitan had taken over and he came and sat in the same station, same place. And I disliked that I sit in the company of Shaitan. And therefore I got up and I left. Oh Abu Bakr, I have three advices for you. It is a right upon Allah that he fulfills these three things to his slave. He says, number one, that there isn't a slave of Allah who is being oppressed. The slave of Allah is being oppressed with whatever it might be. And then the slave of Allah, he decides that I will forgive the one who is oppressing me for the sake of Allah. إِلَّا زَادَهُ اللَّهُ عِزًّا. And when this person does this, then Allah will increase that person in his honor. Many a times we go after honor and name and fame, and it leads to flame. We go after the big bucks. We go after the dunya, seeking name, wanting to be famous. Yet the Messenger of Allah, peace be upon him, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is telling us the formula to receive that honor that we crave and that we want. So he's informing us that when someone wrongs me, let's not become angry and retaliate. Let's not do something silly that we might regret in the future. Rather forgive for the sake of Allah, zadakullah wa izzan. Allah will increase him in his honor. Number two advice that he gives to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu at that time, he says that there isn't a slave of Allah who opens up the door of begging, seeking excessiveness, seeking a lot more, seeking kathra, illa zadahu Allah illa, except that Allah will open the doors of poverty for him. Allah will increase his illa, his lessness, when he will have nothing. So he will go out begging, lifting his hand to people, to the creation around, and he will say, please give me, please give me, please brother, please sister. But he will return with nothing. So Allah is telling us that when it comes to the time of need, when it comes to the time of want, we lift our hands to Allah and we ask Him first. And then the third advice that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he gives to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu at that time, he says that there is not a slave of Allah who gives open-heartedly, يَبْتَغِي بِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ, he's seeking the pleasure of Allah. إِلَّا زَادَهُ اللَّهُ كَثْرًا, إِلَّا زَادَهُ اللَّهُ بِهَا كَثْرًا, except for that Allah will increase him by him giving. So when we open our doors of begging, Allah will take away from us. And when we open our doors of giving, generosity, then Allah will increase us. And this is what we seek from Allah, and we make that Allah accept it from us. Ameen. Now when Allah says to us, وَسَارِعُوا إِلَىٰ مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ, Allah is telling us that rush towards the maghfirah, the forgiveness of your Lord. مَغْفِرَةٍ مِّن رَبِّكُمْ. And not only the mercy of your Lord, we all want Jannah. We all wake up with the intention that I want to attain Jannah. We wake up, we pray our Fajr Salah. We know that when we do our commandments, the rights that Allah has put upon us, that we will attain Jannah. And He gives us certain actions in the Quran through which we can also attain this Jannah. And He has made it easy for us. He's opened up the door for us. So He says that rush towards the mercy of your Lord, the forgiveness of your Lord, and a Jannah, the size of which, the width of which, زَعَرْضُ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ, it's the space which is occupied between the heavens and the earth. Could we imagine that? A Jannah, one Jannah only, waiting for us, the size of which occupies the space between the heavens and the earth. وَعِدَّتْ لِلْمُتَّقِينَ, it has been prepared for those who have taqwa. Who are the ones that have taqwa? الَّذِينَ يُنْفِقُونَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظَ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ, those who spend at the time of affluency, when they are happy, when they have the means to do so, they give. And then when they're in difficulty, they're struggling, there's financial restraint, yet they continue to give. And not only that, and the point and the crux of our discussion here, وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ, and those who swallow their anger. Those who swallow their anger. When you're being provoked, and a reaction is seeked from us, we swallow the anger. وَالْكَاظِمِينَ الْغَيْظِ وَالْعَافِينَ عَنِ النَّاسِ. Allah says, and those who forgive the people, وَاللَّهُ يُحِبُّ الْمُحْسِنِينَ, and Allah loves those who are kind, who are the righteous. Now when we look into the hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we come to know that the strong person isn't the one who can wrestle another and pin him down to the ground, who can, you know, grip him and who can take him down. Many times we go to the gym, we pump the iron, we build the muscles, and we want to get everybody down. We want to show who's got the muscles. We lift our hands and we want to show the little egg that is sticking out. No. Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to us, فَلَيْسَ الشَّدِيدُ بِسْرَعَةِ إِنَّمَا الشَّدِيدُ الَّذِي يَمْلِكُ نَفْسَهُ عِنْدَ الْغَضَبِ, that the strong one is not the one who can wrestle. It's not the one who can take somebody down, grapple him and take him down. But indeed, the only strong one, the word is used innama, and those who understand the Arabic is used for hasr, is to show how limited it is. That indeed, the strong one, the one who possesses power, the one who possesses control over himself, is the one who, when the time of anger comes, he can restrain himself. He doesn't go lashing out. Working as a prison chaplain, one of the advices that we used to give to the brothers there is don't act in haste in anger, because one moment of haste, one moment of anger could lead to a lifetime of regret. To a lifetime of regret. Now does that mean that it is haram to have anger? Does it mean that we are not allowed to be angry? Of course not. It's a human reaction, it's a human emotion. From amongst the emotions that Allah has granted us, this is one of them. And when we look at the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we analyze his life, and we look at the different aspects of his life, we even see that at times he himself had become angry. And when we look at the Shama'il and the description of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we would know, and we come to know, that when he would become angry, the color of his face would change. We would see that his vein would protrude and it would come out on his forehead, and we could, you know, the companions would know, okay, we have done something wrong, or the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is not happy with what we are doing. Imagine, Umar radiallahu anhu, we mentioned this a few khutbahs back. Umar radiallahu anhu, he was one of the literate people at the time who could read and write. So he brings a copy of the Torah, as Imam al-Darimi mentions in his Musnad. He brings a copy of the Torah to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he begins to recite from it. And he's reciting the Torah in front of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the color of the face of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam begins to change. And you can see that he's becoming angry. And Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, who's there at that time, he says, "Oh Umar, you know, what are you doing? Stop. What are you doing? Can you not see what is happening to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam?" And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he addressed Umar radiallahu anhu and said, "Oh Umar, know that if Musa alayhi salam was to appear today in front of us, even he would be compelled to follow me and the Quran. He would have no authority." Subhanallah. But this goes to show that even the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, at times he became angry. But yet the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the most controlled and the most constrained person. We see that at one point a person called Dimad had come into Makkah. And he spoke to the elite of the time. He spoke to the leaders. And they had, so this person, Dimad, who then became a Muslim, radiallahu anhu, he was known for his exorcism. He would come and, you know, draw out the supernatural, the jinnats and things like that from the people. So he had come to Mecca, he spoke to the elite, and they had told him that this is one man called Muhammad within our town. He's causing so much problems, causing havoc, breaking up families, coming up with these new ideas. He's causing havoc. Chaos in the city. Please go deal with him. So Dimad, he went and he approached the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he says that, "I have been informed that you have become possessed. There's something inside of you and you're causing problems. I'm here to cure you. Imagine this. I'm here to cure you. Now, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam had under his control at that time Hamza radiallahu anhu, he had Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, he had Az-Zubair ibn Awam radiallahu anhu. These were the elites and the strongest and the bravest, courageous amongst the Quraysh at the time. He could have said, "Oh Umar, go sort him out. Oh Hamza, go sort him out. Oh Az-Zubair, go sort him out." But no, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he turned, he looked at the face of this person. I didn't say anything other than إِنَّ الْحَمْدَ لِلَّهِ نَحْمَدُهُ وَنَسْتَعِينُهُ وَنَسْتَغْفِرُهُ. And he recited the khutbah that we hear all the time. And the man became shocked. He said, "Repeat it back to me, because I've not heard any words like that. I've not previously heard any words like that before. Repeat it back to me." Again, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam repeated these words back to him. And Dumad radiyallahu anhu, at that time, he says, "Ashhadu annaka Rasulullah." And he accepted Islam at the hands of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at that time. Now imagine if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had reacted in anger, what would have happened? This was our Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We want to walk in his footsteps when it comes to these things. You know, many a times now, we become angered when we see the fortune of others. And we forget what Allah has decreed for us. As the Urdu poet says, "Aaj ke log apne dukh se dukhi nahi hai, balki dusron ke sukh se dukhi hai." Those who understand that will appreciate it. "Aaj ke log apne dukh se dukhi nahi hai, balki dusron ke sukh se dukhi hai." That today's people, they're not worried and they're not frustrated, angered by their own misfortune. It's by the fortune of others that they are angered and they are frustrated and worried. We forget what Allah has put in place for us. And we become angry sometimes at that. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked about the angry person, what should they do? So he instructed us and he advised us that if the person becomes angry whilst he is standing, then allow him to sit down. If he is sitting down, then allow him to lie down. And some of the athar, they want to say that if that does not work, then allow him to do wudu. And actually, I want to quickly mention one incident, and with that we'll conclude the khutbah. As we know, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he says, "Balligh 'anni walaw aya wa hadith 'an bani Israila wa la haraj, wa man kadhaba 'alayya muta'ammidan falyatabawwa maq'ad min an-nar." Now pass on and convey on behalf of me, even if it's one ayah, and narrate from the Banu Israel, and there is no problem in that. And whosoever knowingly attributes a lie towards me, then allow him to prepare his abode in the fire of hell. We seek Allah's protection from that. Ameen. So I just want to focus on the second part. وَحَدِّثُ عَنْ بَنِي إِسْرَائِيلَ وَلَا حَرَجْ. That narrate from the Banu Israel, narrate the Israeliyat, there is no problem in it. And the scholars, they go into a long discussion about it. If you look into the books of Ibn Hajar, Imam al-Nawawi, they go into the discussions. Nevertheless, when we want to narrate stories about the previous nations, we take away the pinch of salt and we make sure that it doesn't contradict our Sharia. So Faqih Abu Layth al-Samarqandi, he mentions in his book an incident about Iblis and Musa alayhi salam. So he says that Iblis came and he spoke to Musa alayhi salam, and he started to pick him up and he started to praise him. Istafakallahu bi risalati wa takallamaka, and he has spoken to you. So Allah has given you the risala, he's given you the prophethood, messengership. He has spoken to you directly. No one else has that same honor. So I have one request. You know, Allah has made you such an honorable person. Please, I have one request. Can you please go and speak to Allah on behalf of me? Because I want to seek repentance. Iblis is saying, "I want to seek repentance. I want Allah's forgiveness." So Musa alayhi salam, he became delighted. He's excited. So what did he do? He performed his ablution and he prayed to Allah and he asked Allah, "Oh Allah, Iblis has come. Oh Allah, Iblis is from amongst the from your creation. He is a creation from amongst your creation. Oh Allah, please forgive him." So Musa alayhi salam was informed that no, he does not want it. So Musa alayhi salam insisted. He insisted. "No, yes, of course, he wants it." So he said, "Okay, oh Musa, because of your honor, I will respect your request and I will grant you that. Go back to Iblis and instruct him to go to the grave of Adam alayhi salam, and inform him and instruct him to do sajda, to prostrate in front of the grave of Adam alayhi salam." So Musa alayhi salam is delighted, he comes back to the place and he speaks to him. He says, Allah is ready to accept your tawbah, your repentance. Only one condition, you just have to go to the grave and prostrate. So he says, how can I do that? How can I do that? I could not prostrate in front of Adam while he was alive, and you expect me to go to his grave whilst he is dead and you want me to prostrate? That's not going to happen, no chance at all. And his kibr came in, his pride, his arrogance had kicked in, he had become angered. So he says, oh Musa, you have done me a favor and therefore you have earned three advices from me. And he says, when three occasions occur, then remember me at that time. Imagine this, this is in Musa, so remember me at this time. And he says, number one, and this is the focus of our topic, he says, the حِينَ تَغْضَبْ, whenever you become angry, then فَإِنِّي فِي قَلْبِكَ أَجْرِي مَجْرَ الدَّمْ, that as soon as you become angry, then I start to circulate in your body just the way your blood circulates in your body. So when we become angry, we need to start seeking the protection of Allah against shaitan. We do not want to say things that we will regret. We do not want to say things that will, that could or maybe take us out to the fold of Islam, that may lead to divorce. You know, alhamdulillah, whilst I was studying the iftar in the mufti class, majority of the questions that the mufti sahab would direct was me was about divorce. And all the time, the scenario was, I was in so much anger that I did not realize what I said. But the issue is, that's not taken into consideration. It's too late then, the damage is caused. I will leave you with one advice that was somebody very near and beloved to me used to say. It says that anger is one letter short of danger. Anger is one letter short of danger. If it's channeled in the right way, it will be rewarded. مَنْ حَبَّ لِلَّهِ وَأَبْغَضَ لِلَّهِ وَأَعْطَى لِلَّهِ وَمَنَعَ لِلَّهِ فَقَدْ اسْتَكْمَلَ الْإِيمَانِ, that whosoever loves for the sake of Allah, becomes angry for the sake of Allah, whosoever gives for the sake of Allah, whoever holds back for the sake of Allah, then he has indeed completed his iman. But sometimes our anger could also lead us towards that which is haram. أَقُولُ قَوْلِ هَذَا وَاسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ لَكُمْ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَاسْتَغْفِرُوهُ إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا, من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له, ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له, ونشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. وبعد, فقد قال الله تعالى في القرآن المجيد والفرقان الحميد, بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم, بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم, إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي, يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما, اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد, اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, أرحم أمتي بأمتي أبو بكر, وأشدهم في أمر الله عمر, وأصدقهم حيان عثمان, وأقضاهم علي, وفاطمة سيدة نساء أهل الجنة, والحسن والحسين سيدا شباب أهل الجنة, وحمزة أسد الله وأسد رسوله, اللهم اغفر لعباس وولده مغفرة ظاهرة وباطنة لا تغادر ذنبا, الله الله في أصحابي لا تتخذوهم غرضا من بعدي, فمن أحبهم فبحبي أحبهم, ومن أبغضهم فببغضي أبغضهم, وخير أمتي قرني ثم الذين يلونهم ثم الذين يلونهم, ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار, ربنا لا تزغ قلوبنا بعد إذ هديتنا وهب لنا من لدنك رحمة إنك أنت الوهاب. عباد الله رحمكم الله, إن الله يأمر بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون, فاذكروني أذكركم واشكروا لي ولا تكفرون, وأقيموا صفوفكم. Thank you.